us today. A couple announcements before we get started. This afternoon is going to be a quartet at the manor right across the street here at 2 p.m. So you're all welcome to go listen. So that's at 2 at the manor. Midweek Bible class is coming back on the second Wednesday, so that'll be October 14th. But what I wrote there is actually not what we're going to be hearing. It was actually an opportunity to hear a missionary from Tokyo, Pastor Jastrin, will be in the area. And so he's going to be coming and speaking to us. So 6:30 on the 14th right back there will be an opportunity to hear him speak about what he's doing along with other Lutherans in China. So it'd be great to see you all there on the 14th. A couple prayer requests this morning. Norman Vandenbroek, that's Dan Vandenbroek, and Kathy Shorman's dad, he passed away this past week. So we want to remember their family in our prayers today, and the hope of the resurrection will be with them. And also, we have a prayer of thanksgiving for 65 years of marriage for Daryl and Beck. So congratulations.
Good morning. How's it going, Dan?
And this is the day which the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
From the rising of the sun to its setting,
the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Make me to know your ways, O Lord.
Teach me your paths.
Sanctify us in your truth.
Your word is truth.
From the rising of the sun to its setting.
The name of the Lord is to be praised.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Spirit registered, but they had not gone out to the tent. And so they prophesied in the camp. And the young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, the son of Nun, the assistant of Moses from his youth, said, "My lord Moses, stop them." So Moses said to him, "Are you jealous of what I say? Oh, would that all the Lord's people were prophets, that the Lord would put his spirit on them." And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle lesson is from James chapter 5, where he talks about prayer. And he reminds us that God is not some vending machine that we just kind of kick every time we want something. But he does say that the prayer of faith is heard by God. He doesn't despise his people's prayers. And this faith in Christ saves and forgives. So from James 5. "Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore confess your sins to one another, and pray for one another, and may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. But then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. My brothers, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone brings him back, let him know that whoever brings back a sinner from his wandering will save his soul from death, and will cover a multitude of sins. And this is the word of the Lord." Our gospel lesson is from Mark chapter 9, and this is kind of, Jesus covers a lot, it's kind of difficult, but the context is Jesus' disciples were arguing over whose graves. And so in this one, he'll continue to humble them. They're mad that someone else is working all these miracles in Jesus' names, and Jesus says, "I'm glad that someone's preaching the word about me." And then he'll go on to talk about how the least in his kingdom are the greatest. Anyone who would hurt them, he will avenge. He goes on to encourage the disciples to be salty, that is, to have life in them and to vibrancy and to share his word. And so lots of things in here, but he's just reminding the disciples to be out there and to be working and be thankful that other people are too. So, from Mark 9, John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him, because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a mighty work in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. For the one who is not against us is for us. For truly I say to you, whoever gives a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ will by no means lose his reward. And whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, oh, it would be better for him if a great millstone were hung around his neck and were thrown into the sea. And if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than with 2 hands to go into hell and unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than with 2 feet to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than with 2 eyes to be thrown into hell. The worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. And salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how will you make it salty again? So have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens.
Honor your father and mother. You shall not murder.
believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
You may be seated. At this time, we need children to pray for a brief object.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you, from our God and Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. There's a website called Reasons My Son is Crying. It's a website where you can post pictures of your children throwing their tantrums, and then in the caption you post theological reasons why. For example, there's a picture posted there of this boy in tears, and the caption underneath read, "Because I wore pants today." Another showed this two-year-old crying, and the caption read, "I wouldn't let them lick the doormat." And I think anyone with children could think of a few examples they could throw in. And it's kind of funny when you have kids like this. They're crying for these pointless reasons. And yet, at the end of the day, you just have to laugh and help them through their little things and quirks. But even adults cry, hopefully for a better reason than a doormat or a pair of pants. But I think if we are honest, we know some are, and maybe we ourselves, who, even as adults, have cried over something pointless before. Because that's one way we react to stuff that isn't fun. But how we react to stuff that isn't fun is actually quite telling. Or maybe I'll say it this way. There are ways to cry that are better than others. For example, no one wants to get the wrong order at the fast food joint. You ordered cheese on your burger, and you didn't get any, even though you paid the extra quarter. That's not good. It's not what you wanted. But have you ever seen someone just yell and scream at the fast food worker about it? I have. And it's kind of pathetic. Sure, go ask to get it fixed. But acting like a two-year-old, it's not helpful and it's a little bit sad. And it's exactly what God's people in our Old Testament lesson today were doing. They were going through a hard time. Yes, they were. They had been living in tents in the wilderness for a year now, and they had been eating nothing but manna, a bread that does taste like honey, but they've been eating it for a year. Now, would you want to live in a desert and eat the same bread for a year? No. So I did it. They were sick and tired of it, and they were unhappy. That's fine. But they don't cry to God for help. They don't ask Moses, their leader, to look into it. They grumble against God and Moses. Now, grumbling is the adult version of the two-year-old tantrum. It is angst mixed with anger and with a side of unbelief. They ignore the fact that in Egypt, they were slaves. They were whipped. They only remember that they got to eat fish and cucumbers and onions. They forget that God miraculously saved them from Pharaoh, tried to kill them, and how God brought them through the sea. Instead, they grumble, and they wish God never brought them into that wilderness and left them to die in Egypt. They forget that at Sinai, God promised them a covenant, that they were his people, and he would watch over them and bring them to a promised land. And instead, they simply accuse God of hating them and Moses being a terrible leader. I'm sure a few of them thought God wasn't real. You see, the people didn't cry out in faith or in prayer. No, they grumbled against. And have you ever done the same? I have. Rather than bearing with someone, you toss a few remarks and you cut them down. Maybe you've been that person at the fast food restaurant throwing a tantrum. You see, we have our bad days and our bad moods, but that doesn't make it okay to hurt others with our grumbling. If you've got a problem, by all means, speak up, but we as Christians are called to speak that truth in love, not to cut someone down or to go behind their back. That's grumbling against someone. That's for two-year-olds. But we still do it. Against others, against God too, right? If you're real, God, show me a sign and prove it to me. God, why did you let this happen to me? Are you mad at me? Don't you care about me? Are you even real? say this in your word, but it's dumb, it's outdated, and isn't it fun? Why are you so mean and hateful? God, you can't possibly expect me to forgive that person. After what they did to me? How come they have all the health and the money? Not me, God, that isn't fair. You see, I thought a few of those things. Have you? We are no different than God's people of old. We grumble when bad things happen to us, and when good things happen to others. So let us learn from God's people of old. Let us learn that first of all, grumbling is sin. It's unbelief. And please don't get me wrong, it's okay to cry out to God. He wants us to pray to Him whenever we are in need, and He listens like a dear father. The warning in our lesson today is to against letting our situation in life dictate our relationship with God. The warning today is to remind us that in spite of our situation in life, there is never a reason to curse God. Yes, bad things happen to us, terrible things, and we don't always know why. Specifically, because He doesn't spell out why He got a flat tire in the Bible. But He does tell us that we are sinners in a sinful world, and we do know that He's God, and we aren't. He's the potter, and if He wants to make a vessel of wrath out of us and let bad things come our way, He can. If He wants to give His pastor cancer at 28, He can. But the cry of faith says, all right, God, You've let this hardship come my way, and I need Your help. And He listens. Shoot, even when His Old Testament people grumble, He still blessed them with His Spirit, as we heard today. So when we cry out in faith, of course He will listen. So when bad things happen in life, when you're in a desert, stuck eating bread for a year, when you lose the promotion, when the vote goes the other way, when the doctor gives you the bad news, cry out to God, yes, and He will hear you. Because even though He lets bad things happen, it doesn't mean He doesn't care. You see, He let bad things happen to His disciples. They were thrown in jail and killed. Did He not care about them? Of course He did. God knows we go through hard times, and He's gone through them too. He was hungry in the wilderness, and when He was tempted, He ate no bread. He was poor, He was made fun of, He was grumbled against and treated unfairly. He was beaten, He was jailed, and He was killed. God knows what suffering is like, and He never grumbled. He called out to His Father for help. He commended Himself to the Father, even as He died alone for sins He never committed. And He went through all that for you and me, who grumble all the time. He went through it to forgive us. He went through it so that no matter what comes our way, we can know God isn't mad at us, He loves us. And because Jesus rose, we can know that no matter what happens, we can have hope. Sure and certain hope that one day the suffering, the pain, the disease will die. But we won't. We live forever in a promised land of a new creation with an abundance of food and freedom and a place where there will be truly nothing to grumble about anymore. And until that day, be patient in suffering. Call upon His name, He will give you grace. And when you fall short, remember that thanks to Jesus, you're forgiven. And remember also that God is patient. The people in the Old Testament grumbled against Him. He didn't wipe them out. He did send them some hard times, yes, but He was also patient with them. And He poured His Spirit out on them so that they might know that they were not forgotten or alone. And He was with them and He would see them through it. And He does the same for us. He has poured out His Holy Spirit on us in the Word and baptism. So you can know that He has come to you. He loves you. And no matter what happens in your life, that doesn't change. He will see you through the valley of shadow. Thanks be to God, who has mercy on the grumblers like us. Amen. Our service continues as we worship God with our eyes.
Thank you.
met there. So let's end with the common table prayer. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let